community. We deeply feel that we must remain connected with the American public, and opportunities like this, although I leave the Pentagon very rarely, I jumped at this opportunity, and having it on a Sunday made it a little bit easier, but I thank you for inviting us. It's very important work that we do. You know, my father was in the military. He spent 26 and a half years in the Army, and he was a sergeant. And I was convinced after watching him first go through the desegregation Truman executive order. I mean, I didn't watch that. I wasn't born, but I knew about it. Fight in Korea, and then fight in Vietnam, and then live the life of a soldier for 26 and a half years with my mom and five kids. I was convinced that's not what I wanted to do. So I have 33 and a half years in the service, and I'm convinced he left early. So when you think about what I do, I listen to the title, and sometimes I have a hard time explaining what it is I do. I'm kind of like the head human resource person for the Army, and I have a lot of responsibilities in that. But suffice it to say, we have 1.1 million soldiers in the Army. We have 330,000 civilians. About 60% of our Army is married, so families matter. We have active, we have reserve, and we have National Guard. That's the Army, and that's who I work for. And they all have my email address and write me frequently. But it is a joy to serve for them. I thought I'd run through a list of things that are on the plate of the Army and that we're working today. Some of them we'll get to, some of them cross into what David was talking about. But as we go into the question and answer period, there are some topics that may not be in line with the theme of today's session, but you may have a question on it. So I want to just talk about some of those. First and foremost, our mission is to win our nation's wars. And we are doing that in Iraq and Afghanistan, and we're in other places around the world, doing what the Congress and the American people in the present expect us to do. In doing that for 10 years as an army at war, we are very concerned about the health of our force. No one would have guessed, I think, that we would be at this war for this long, with many soldiers who have only known war since they've joined this military. So the stress is significant. There are a lot of negative signs that we're seeing in a number of different areas, whether it's suicides that have increased from 2011 from about 50 suicides in our active Army to well over 160 by 2010. So we've tripled the suicides. We have alcohol abuse in some of our soldiers that have stood in combat formations for many years. We're seeing signs of child abuse and sexual abuse and assaults. Our wounded warrior population has increased significantly. We have 300 amputees. 26 of them are serving in combat today, something that we did not do in the past. Very few amputees even stayed with our Army. Folks like Secretary Shinseki, who is an amputee and has led the charge along with gentlemen like General Retired Fred Franks, that amputees can continue to serve, and other wounded, ill, and injured soldiers can continue to serve in our military. We have a number of cases of post-traumatic stress. We have traumatic brain injuries in significant numbers from the type of the war that we're fighting. On another topic many of you may know that we have been engaged in, I'm sure, is the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And I sat on the commission that reviewed that for over a year with the General Counsel of the Department of Defense, Jay Johnson, and General Carter Hamm. And it was recently repealed, and I think the Army, our military, will do just fine. We're working on a topic near and dear to my heart, and that's women in our military and how they serve and where they serve. We still have policies that talk about the front line of troops, which women are well beyond, and we don't serve and we don't fight in that fashion anymore. So we've got to review our policies on women. Religious accommodations. We're about potentially to go to court in some cases of religious freedoms that different soldiers wish to have in terms of wearing beards and turbans and and longer hair and different jewelry and items that recognize their religious freedoms? And how do we bounce that against the strict discipline, policy, and uniformity that is necessary in our Army? I spent 4 years as the head recruiter of the Army, so I've been all over America and the world, reaching out to colleges and universities, high schools, trying to ensure that we can tell our story. I was in the Pentagon during 9/11 and worked very closely with Secretary Rumsfeld and the President in many of the decisions that were made on that day and the subsequent days, and have been deployed to Bosnia, Iraq, and other places around the world. I just wanted to give you that background, so as you think about the questions that you would like to ask, I'm prepared to talk all about that. And despite the health and stress of our force, I wanted to just say that this is the best trained, best equipped, and best led Army that this country has ever fielded. And we are ready to do what the nation asks us to do anywhere in any place, and I'm very, very proud to serve. It is an all-volunteer Army, and there are differences of opinion, but I and many other leaders prefer an all-volunteer force for a number of reasons that we can talk about today. There's a myth that many folks can serve in the Army. The fact is less than 3 out of 10 high school students or those in the age of 17 to 24-year-old can actually wear this uniform. They are unqualified because of education aptitude. They are unqualified because of their medical conditions. And they are unqualified because of their conduct. So when you see a soldier, he's one of those less than 3 out of 10 that can wear this uniform. Not everybody can serve. Secretary of Defense Robert Gates said, "Most Americans honor and respect those who have chosen to serve, but to most citizens, this war is an abstraction, a distant and unpleasant series of news items that do not affect them personally." This is why I think it's important for us to engage and have this opportunity to speak with you today. I go to many different functions across the country as the head recruiter, and I remember walking into one hotel, and I was going down the elevator, and there was a lady on the hotel elevator, and she said, "You're looking mighty fine in that uniform." So I took a step back, and I said, "Okay." And she said, "Have you made sergeant yet?" I looked up to make sure I had my rank on. You know, at that time I was a 2-star, and I said, "Well, no, I'm actually an officer." She says, "Oh, okay, I understand. So have you made captain?" But America understand, and you know, I felt pretty good about that. I didn't feel at all bad that at least America, those that really aren't in touch with Americans, that they're not thinking about generals and the senior leaders. They're thinking about sergeants and captains. And it's those sergeants and captains and those below them that are carrying the bulk of combat force. But we do need to reach out. We do need to continue to stay connected to America. We're about to draw down our Army. You've heard it in the news. In the active Army, we have about 570,000 soldiers. We're going to draw it down to about 520,000 by fiscal year 16. So about 50,000 soldiers will leave the end strength of our Army. That said, every year about 150,000 soldiers transition and leave the military, and we need your help. We need your help not just in thanking our soldiers, airmen, military, all alike for their service, but help them in the transition. Again, in that age group of the younger age group of our military, 18 to 24-year-old, about 30% of them are unemployed. Each year, I pay unemployment compensation. That's part of my budget. My budget is about $62 billion, and part of my budget is to pay unemployment compensation. About $500 million a year goes to unemployed soldiers that are looking for jobs. Many of these are very, very talented soldiers. They're medics that have saved lives for individuals across the battlefields of Iraq and Afghanistan, but they don't have the credentials to work as a medic in an emergency medical team in a hospital. And what we're asking is for some ability to transition these soldiers taking some risk in society. You heard that I taught engineering at West Point. My wife is an elementary school principal. If I wanted to go teach elementary math in her school tomorrow, if I took off my uniform, I cannot do that. I have a lot of certification requirements and other things that I currently don't have time to do. And this isn't about me, but many others have the same challenges that they must get certified in the states where they need to be certified in order to take on a job. So we'd ask for some assistance as they move on. Since the beginning of our country, two institutions have sustained our democracy. One is the United States Army, the military, and the other is public education. Frances Hesselbein said that. She's the winner of the Presidential Medal of Freedom. But those are the two institutions that we have to sustain. My family is involved in both, with my wife as an elementary school principal. And the Army is all about education. As I found going across the country, many thought that the military was not interested in education. Nothing could be further from the truth. Last year, in the 9/11 GI Bill, we spent more than $5 billion in money for college for men and women of the armed forces. More than 60 million of that money was used here in Massachusetts in schools in 2010 and 2011. Just last year, during the year, about $240,000 was spent on tuition assistance, where soldiers, while in the Army, were taking courses online, courses in their local community, courses while serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. And I'll close here by talking about a soldier from St. Paul, Minnesota, and what he said when he was a senior in high school. He wrote a credo paper outlining how he wanted to live his life. Michael was excellent in sports, and he loved football, wrestling, weightlifting, and skiing. He thrived on competition and the rush and the throngs of all of those in the crowds that would yell and scream his name and the others on his team. But while he could have pursued an athletic career, both in college and then perhaps in the pros, he decided against it. He wrote, "When I am on my deathbed, when I'm going to look back on 30 years is going to be important to me. Will it be 30 years of playing a game that in reality means nothing? Or will it be 30 years of protecting the country from all enemies, foreign and domestic? I want to fight for something, be a part of something that is greater than myself." Michael was killed in a Bradley fighting vehicle that overturned in Iraq, and he was 22 years old. My job is to make sure that soldiers like Michael and the many like him have everything they need to execute their mission for this country each and every day. Thank you.